don't deserve such a love. Something so kind and true. Why do you still call out my name? For me to believe that you would go that far to reach out for me, and who would send their only son to die on a tree? And who would give someone like me? Oh, I can't comprehend the sacrifice, or why you would pay the highest price to break these shackles off my feet and take this burden right off of me. I don't deserve another chance after turning my back on you. Somehow you grab my hand and tell me that you have made me new. They tell me you've forgiven me, but it's still hard for me to see. The hope that you said is still left for me. And who would say
yes, ma'am, if you come up here, I'd appreciate it. All right. Again, good morning. Shabbat shalom, everyone. I hope everyone's doing well this morning. Okay, all right. Hope everyone out there is doing well this morning. So we're going to get started real quick. Just kind of a little bit of a, not an issue, but just a question. We had permission from the museum to park over there, but I understand that a couple of you ran into a little problem this morning over there. So we apologize for that. We had gotten permission in advance. I don't know if they've got something going on over there today that they're needing those spots, but our apologies for that, because they didn't hadn't said anything other than what they told us at the very beginning. So if that created an issue for you this morning, we're very, very sorry, and we'll check into that later this week. In the meantime, y'all come on in and join us, and we're going to begin in prayer. And then Adam and Jerry's not here, and Chris isn't here. So Adam, you and all the other gentlemen and ladies, if you want to join them, we're going to sound the shofar in just a moment. But let's all stand and let's go to the Father in prayer. And Abby, I'm cold. Looking at your bare feet, I'm just cold. All righty. All right. Our Father in heaven, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you, Father, for the sunshine. And although we really, really appreciate the rain that you send to the land, we're also happy that it's not raining and snowing today. And we're just thankful for the sun. Thank you so much. And Father, we just pray that throughout this day, let our focus be only to please you, to honor you, to worship you, to commune and fellowship with you. We pray, Father, that you'll help us, that you'll encourage and enable us to lay aside all things of the past week and all the things that we'll be facing next week, that in our hearts and our minds and even in our bodies, that we would cease and desist from those things that are common and everyday, that we may truly set this day apart in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives, that we can enjoy this fellowship with you and enjoy this fellowship with one another. I pray, Father, for those who are weak in body, those who are weak in mind, those who have come discouraged, those who have come challenged. We pray, Father, that you will equip them right now by your Spirit to put those things aside and to help us all to rise above our circumstances, that, again, that this day may truly be set apart so that your presence would fill this place, that your presence would fill our hearts and minds, our lives, so that everything that we do here today, every prayer, every song, every word spoken, it will sanctify your great name, that you will find it pleasing in your sight, and that we will know that when we leave this place, that we have been with you. I pray that you will bless our fellowship with one another, that you will guide our conversation with one another, and to help us in everything we do, lift up the name of Yeshua, our Messiah, that he may be praised. These things we ask humbly and believing that you will meet us in Yeshua's name. Amen. Matovu, O Halecha Yaakov, Mishkenotecha Yisrael. Matovu, O Halecha Yaakov. Sisters that want to come up and sound the shofar this morning? Anyone else? And may it be when they sound the shofar that all of those things that the adversary would want to try to do to stand in the way of what the Father wants to do today, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Amen? Sound the shofar.
Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Behold, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together. In unity, in unity. La 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 la. In unity, in unity. La 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 la. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov u'manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. Hine matzov, hine matzov. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la.
Good morning. Good morning. Shabbat Shalom again.
I think we fit everybody in here today. What do you know about that? Everybody doing all right? Everybody happy it's not raining? The sun is shining in the sky. My Jeep, so I have a Jeep Wrangler. It floods because it has a soft top. Yeah, it's just part of the deal. So I've had it tarped up for so long because of all the rain, mold was growing it and everything. So I had to clean all that. But yesterday I opened it up and just let the sun shine down and everything dried out. So that is an out-of-tune guitar. That's better. Now arise, O Lord, to your resting place with all your power and might. As we stand here clothed in your righteousness, we will sing and dance for joy. For you have chosen Zion as a place for you to dwell. We will run to the mountain of God. We will sound the alarm. Salvation is come. We will dance, we will praise, we will worship the name. And oh, we'll bow before the glory of God. Glory of God. Y'all, I think it's time to change the strings on this guitar. I'm going to stop just about every song just to change it. This day We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our breath. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes, 'cause you're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing.
Our desire for you to come and meet us here. Where two or more are gathered in your name, we know that you are in the midst. And so we know without a doubt you're here. You're the reason that we sing. Reveal another facet of your face to us this morning, Father. Walk into the room and do whatever you want. We are open, we are hungry for an encounter. 'Cause when you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light. worship you. Oh, we worship you. Sing, we love you. We love you. And we'll never stop. We can't live without you, Jesus. We love you. And we can't get enough. All this is for you, ceases to exist.
When you walk into the room, the dead begin to rise, cause there is resurrection life in all you do. And we love you, and we'll never stop.
So come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you. Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you. Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you. So come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you. Consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you,
oh, we want you. One more time, come.
Oh, come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you, we want you.
So come, oh,
come and consume, God, all.
We love you.
Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord and Holy Spirit, you are welcomed here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
There's nothing worth more.
There's nothing worth more that can never come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord.
I've tasted and seen.
And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, oh, Holy Spirit, you are welcomed here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence,
Holy Spirit.
Oh, Holy Spirit, you are welcome to come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your good.
Let us become.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. And Holy Spirit, you are welcome, dear. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
One more time.
Holy Spirit. Your glory, God, our hearts. hearts long for to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Up
your worship right there. Put his name upon your lips, the worthy King of glory. that's for me and my house. We will serve you, Lord, lifting holy hands in worship. And we will not bow down to the gods of men. We will worship the God of Israel. For you are holy. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, lifting holy hands in worship. We will not bow down to the gods of men. We will worship the God.
This day you will serve.
But as for me
and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We'll serve you, Lord.
Yeah.
We will not bow to the gods of men. We will not bow to the gods of men. Worship the God of Israel.
Let's pray. Father, we acknowledge, we profess, we confess that there is nothing that has gone on in our lives that rises above the fact that you are worthy of it all, that you are holy, that you are high and lifted up, and you are worthy of every praise, every song of adoration, every profession of our confidence and our faith in you. And I just pray, Father, that we will collectively acknowledge that in your holiness, in your righteousness, in your goodness, that our situations should fall, melt away from our mind and our heart at this moment so that it can be completely fixed upon you, because you are holy. And we will not bow to the gods of man. Neither will we bow to the worry, the frustration, the fear, the consternation that we oftentimes allow to creep into our lives. We will not bow to those things either, because we acknowledge that you are holy. And so we pray, Father, that you will accept and receive our praise and our adoration today, that what we do will be pleasing in your sight and in your hearing, and that your presence would be welcome in this place, that you would know that you are welcome in this place, in my heart and the hearts of everyone here, and that collectively, as we minister to you, that you would minister to us those things that we so desperately need so that we can be the people you've called us to be. These things we pray and ask in Yeshua's name. Amen. Let's all continue to stand. And we are going to go through our liturgy. But I just, again, I know I often do this, but I just want to remind everyone that we're not just reciting things just because this is what we do in this part of the service. We are acknowledging, we are declaring things. We are professing things. We are opening our mouths so that the heavens and the earth will hear what we are confessing today, what we are declaring. So let's never let it become a routine, a religious rite. Let it always be something that is personal to us. And as a congregation, let it be something that it's something of intimacy. So let's recite together the Vishamru. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbath you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And Father, we pray that we, as we rest in you, will be refreshed today. Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Yeshua answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second like it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Shema Yisrael. With all of your heart. Adonai Eloheinu. Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuto. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his name and his glorious kingdom forever. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha bechal levavcha u'bechal nafshecha u'bechal meodecha, and you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength. Ve'ahavta lerecha kamocha. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And upon these two commandments stands the whole law. Love your neighbor, love your God. Ve'ahavta, ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha bechol levavcha ubechol nafshecha ubechol meodecha, and you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your mind, with all of your strength.
Clap your hands. I can't hear you. Now, rub elbows or shake hands if you feel courageous. And just greet someone. Smile. Gentlemen, if we could get the chuppah, please. So now, if we could get all of our young men and women, Hadassah's always first. Let's get all of our young men and women, boys and girls, to gather under the chuppah. Someone sent us an email asking, they thought the chuppah was just for marriages and weddings, and why do we get our children under there? Pay attention later on, because I will make a comment to answer that question. All right, we got everybody under here. So, again, and just because we may have some people joining us online that haven't been with us before, we're going to sing this song, but we're not just going to treat it as a song. This is our prayer and our belief that the Father, when we pray and place a blessing upon our children, that our Father in heaven will honor that and that he will put his hand upon our children. So let's extend your hands this way, everyone.
May the Lord protect and defend you. May he always shield you from shame. May you come to be in Israel a shining name. May you be like Ruth and like David. May you be deserving of praise. Strengthen them, O Lord, and keep them from the stranger's ways. May God bless you and grant you long lives. May God make you good husbands and wives. May the Lord protect and defend you. And peace, oh, hear our Sabbath prayer.
Amen. Abba, we come before you this day. We thank you for the great blessing you have bestowed upon your people and these children. We ask, Father, that as you are our Father, that you would strengthen us as fathers and as mothers to be the shining light and the guiding path for these young ones, that they may know only your truth, that they will be guided in only your ways, and that they will be strengthened in accordance with your will to accomplish your purpose. Father, we ask this under the authority of your Son, our Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
Thank you. You may return to your seats. As we get back in our seats, I have asked Melody to do something very special today. Yesterday, right now. Yesterday, when they were rehearsing the music for today, after they had finished rehearsing, she just started playing and singing. And as she was singing, I was back there in the office kind of getting prepared for today. And as she was singing this song, I just began to weep. And so I said, you're going to sing that song. She protested. But I pulled the pastor card. Sing it, honey.
I sing because I'm free.
Let's just thank him because he watches over all of us. Maybe I shouldn't say this, but if you can listen to that and not cry, I don't know what's wrong with you. Amen. Thank you, sweetie. I appreciate that. And I think there's a lot of people here that appreciate the fact that he does watch over us. Even when we're sometimes seduced into thinking that he doesn't care, nobody cares, we know he's still watching over us. Amen?
Amen.
All righty. Before we go any further, I just want to make sure that everyone has some place to sit. Robert Losey, I tell you what, I love this man. He is on top of everything before I can even say anything, and I appreciate that. All right, so we're bringing in some extra chairs. We want to try to get as many people in here as can be, and hopefully families sitting together. All right. I sing because I'm happy. Are you? I sing because I'm free. His eyes are on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Father, we thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Thank you just for that simple truth, that you watch over us, that your eye is upon your people. You care for your people. You're on our side. And I just pray, Father, that you'll help us in our times when we aren't feeling that way, that you'll remind us. You have not forsaken, you will not forsake, but that you will continually lead, guide, and sometimes poke and prod, because you want to see us through to that time when we come into the fullness of what you've called us to be, when we thank you. Amen. Our Torah portion today, and by the way, welcome everybody that's joining us online. We're going to make sure to greet you as a congregation here in a little bit. But we want to say welcome to you and thank you for joining us again. I just kind of checked in online to see what was going on, and we have some folks that are just every week who are joining us faithfully and being part of this group as best they can. So welcome. All right, our Torah portion is called Yitro or Jethro, and it begins in Exodus chapter 18, verse 1. I'm going to read through verse 5 as we begin. It says, "And Jethro, the priest of Midian, Moses' father-in-law, heard of all that God had done for Moses and for Israel, his people,
that the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her back with her two sons, of whom the name of one was Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a foreign land. The word Ger means stranger. Sham is here. I was a stranger there. And the name of the other was Eliezer, for he said, the God of my father, Eli, was my help, Ezer, and delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh. And Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came with his sons and with his wife to Moses in the wilderness, where he was encamped at the mountain of God. And so, as I said, this Torah portion is called Yitro. And in Hebrew, for I know we have a lot of folks who are learning Hebrew and wanting to kind of incorporate this into their study, but that the spelling is Yud Tav Resh Vav. And there's a reason that I wanted to point that out, and we'll come back to this in just a moment, later on. But it's Yud Tav Resh Vav here, Yitro. Now, according to the text, he was a distinguished personality in Midian, which, by the way, you should remember or know that Midian is in what we now call the Arabian Peninsula. It's now Saudi Arabia. And so this is where he was from. This was his people. And he was a distinguished personality. Some people even comment that the word or name Yitro might even be a title, kind of like Pharaoh. I'm not going to get into all that. But what we remember is that this is Moses' father-in-law. But we should also consider some things that are very important here that are brought out in these few verses that we read, and that is that being a priest of Midian, as Israel is concerned, he is an outsider. But sometimes we see that the Creator will bring in outsiders not to disrupt, but to actually assist, to help, because he's going to provide counsel to Moses specifically that is going to benefit Israel at large. And basically that counsel was, Moses, you can't do all of this. You're going to have to get some help. And so you need to find some men that can help you in that. More about that later. Anyway, this outsider provides wise counsel to Israel. But we also see in this story that he will bring in, quote unquote, outsiders who will acknowledge the mighty works of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, who will acknowledge his sovereignty, and who will abandon their old ways and join themselves to the people of Israel because of the mighty works of the God of Israel. And of course, later on, he's going to be joined by people like Rahab and Ruth and Elijah and you and me. Because that's why we're all here today, right? Now, the Bible tells us that Jethro had heard about all of the plagues, the splitting of the sea, and all the other events, and that prompted him to go and join Moses and to rejoin Moses with his wife, Zipporah, and his two sons, because apparently after that little encounter when God was going to kill Moses and his wife threw the knife down at his feet, we'll go with that, apparently he sent them back home. But he is seeing this as an opportunity to reunite Moses' family with him at Horeb. Now, here's why I wanted to point that out. Here's an outsider hearing these things, recognizing the Creator's sovereignty, and making the choice to join people together. In the previous chapter, we read about how this group called Amalek, the Amalekites, they heard the same things. They got the same reports. But what did they decide to do? So there's this juxtaposition between two different peoples, if you will, hearing the same things, observing the same things, but coming to very different conclusions. Because Jethro decided to join himself to Israel in support of the Creator's purposes, but Amalek, hearing the same things, decided to attack Israel and try to undermine God's purposes. And by the way, attacking the weakest of them from behind. That's in Exodus chapter 17. And by the way, consequently, God declared war on Amalek and is still at war with Amalek. So how is it then, and this is the point I wanted to lead off with, how is it that people can see the same thing, hear the same thing, observe the same things, and yet come to two different, very different views, so far apart? And so it seems that there are those who acknowledge the hand of God, and there are those who do not. There are those who see the glass half full, and there are those who see the glass half empty. Now, I know that's apples and oranges, but nevertheless, you're looking at the same thing. You come to two different conclusions. Now, in my family, I will tell on myself. My wife is the optimist. I'm the pessimist. She sees the glass half full. I see how much of it is empty. And I will tell you that over the years, that has caused issues to arise in our household. And I just decided that it's better to be at peace than it. Never mind. I'm just. No, I'm playing. I'm playing. It's not good to be the person who's always seeing the glass half empty, because that allows things to enter into your mind and into your heart, and it will lead to other things that are not so good. So I'm not saying that we all need to be the eternal optimist. I think sometimes we have to be realistic about the way things are. But my point is that there are those people who see God doing things, or they see God using people, or we sense that God is about to do something, and people can, if we're not careful, arrive at a not so good conclusion. Amalek interpreted these events as a provocation to attack and to go against Israel. There are things that happen in our lives, personally, we see somebody else, or the nation, and we'll see hardships as a call to repentance. I believe that there's always, that's my first response when we're going through hardships as a family. Okay, what is it you're trying to say to us? Is there something in our lives you're trying to bring our attention to try to correct? And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But there are others who will look at those things and unfortunately will exploit them for their own agendas. That's what Amalek did. This is apples and oranges as well, but I want to underscore the point I'm trying to make here. President Trump. Some people think he's God's man. Some people think he's the Antichrist. All right? And I'm not here to be political, and I'm not here to be an advocate for or an opponent of. My point is, people can see, and I'm talking about believers, can look at the same person and come to two different conclusions. I think what we need to do as God's people is to discern God's purpose rather than examining the person. All right? So, because if we can get focused on what his purpose is rather than the person, then maybe we can see the bigger picture. All right, and I'm not talking about Trump again. I'm just talking about in general. Because when we look at people, you know what we do? We start picking them apart. That is our tendency as people. If you spent day in, day out with me, like this woman has for 30-something years, you would know there were some things about me you wouldn't like. Some of you may have already determined, without having to spend all that time with me, there are things that you don't particularly like. And the truth of the matter is, if I spent some time with you, I would probably find some things about you that I don't like. However, that's why we shouldn't focus on the person. We need to focus on his purpose. And so Yitro is a reminder to us that we need to look at what the Father has done as it relates to his purpose rather than focusing on the people. Because Yitro saw the events as a means to join people back together, reunite a family in this particular case, and also personally for him to join Israel. And so now I want to show you something here. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 18, Yitro is introduced to us as Yeter. So Jonathan, if you'll put that Hebrew up there on the screen for me, I'd appreciate it. Yeter. Now, when I showed you the name Yitro, the difference is this. Yeter is spelled Yud Tav Resh. Yitro is spelled Yud Tav Resh Vav. And so the letter Vav is added to his name here in Exodus 18. Why is that important, Bill? I'm glad you ask. Because Vav, it means a hook. It's something that is intended to join things together. Vav is the word that is used in relation to the tabernacle when the different curtains had to be joined together. So it's interesting that he's using a quote-unquote outsider to facilitate a joining together of a family and for him to join himself to this people called Israel. And so we would presume that being this high-profile personality he was in that region of the world, then he would have had influence on others that perhaps they also would join. You think about Ruth. What did she do? She reunited Naomi with her inheritance. How did she do that? By going and gleaning in the field of Boaz, and then she marries Boaz. She's joined to him. And so she becomes the ancestor of not only King David, but of the son of David as well. So it's very important to see that, again, in this particular case, the Creator used an outsider to help bring people back together. That's what the Vav is implicating. It's joining things together. Now, we also need to understand that the Vav is the sixth letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and so in rabbinical works, it has come to be representative of man, because man is identified with six. Man was created on the sixth day, you know, and all these different ideas behind it. So what I would deduce from that then is this. From the Creator's perspective, man's not here to divide. Man is here to join. A man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife, and the two shall become lebasar echad, unto one flesh. So we are, as his people, to work toward joining together, coming together, encouraging others to join, those that acknowledge his handiwork, his greatness, his sovereignty, who acknowledge that, and they want to join themselves to that. And so this is a theme that we're going to see in this Torah portion again as well. In Exodus 18, verse 9, it says that Jethro rejoiced for all the goodness which the Lord had done to Israel. So this guy's an outsider, but he is rejoicing in all of these things that he's hearing. Even though he's not an Israeli, he is rejoicing at Israel's deliverance. In verse 10, it said that he blessed the Lord for Israel's deliverance, and he acknowledged his sovereignty. And in verse 11, he makes this profession. Now I know that the Lord, or the Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, is greater than all of the gods. And from this point forward, tradition has it anyway, that he forsook idolatry and then he began to follow the God of Israel. In fact, in verse 12, it says that he presented a burnt offering to the Creator and then he celebrated with Aaron and Moses in a festive meal. Now, thinking back to prior Torah portions, you remember that when Moses first goes into Pharaoh and says, let my people go that we can go 3 days journey in the wilderness to keep a feast in the Lord. And Pharaoh said, I don't know Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Who is he? I don't know him. And neither will I let Israel go. And so the plagues were the Creator's way of introducing himself to Pharaoh. So that by the end of the process, Pharaoh knows Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Because he said, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Well, this is keeping with that because now, even after the plagues, after the Passover, passing through the sea, we're over here at the foot of Mount Sinai, and what is Jethro more or less confessing? He knows that the God of Israel is God. So I want to juxtapose that now with this. According to the Scripture, one of the most tragic verses in all of Scripture, as far as I'm concerned, is when Yeshua acknowledges that there will be those who think they know him, but he says, I never knew you. And that goes back to the idea that there are many who know about him, but how many truly know him? And if you'll allow me, I want to link that thought to another that we mentioned. Is it possible to focus on the person and not the purpose and be deluded into thinking you know him when in reality you know about him? You'll have to ponder that perhaps, but in my mind it makes sense. So it behooves us to do whatever we have to do to go beyond the point in our relationship that it's not just knowing about him. It's truly knowing him. And if we know him, that means, or at least suggests, that we're going to in some degree, discern his purposes. All right. Again, comparing Jethro to Amalek. Heard the same events, came to very different conclusions. And so, unfortunately, we may be surprised in the future to find out who actually knows him compared to who knows about him. We may be shocked to find out how people respond to what God is doing or what we think he's getting ready to do or even who he is using. Because Yeshua in Matthew chapter 21 says this, beginning in verse 31, "Assuredly I say to you that tax collectors and harlots," and that's the polite word, right? "That tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you." He's speaking to religious people here. "For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you didn't believe him. But tax collectors and harlots believed him. And when you saw it, you did not afterward relent and believe him." So there have always been those whose perception of what God was doing, is doing, is about to do, who he's using, all of those things was wrong. You don't have to answer out loud, but have you ever thought God was going to do this and it turned out you were wrong? I'll raise my hand on that one. Okay? Have you ever been surprised to find who God is using to do certain things? I got surprised back in November 2016. That'll catch up with you, the rest of you, in just a moment. Okay? Okay? I've been surprised almost every day of my walk in what he's doing, how he's doing it, who he's using. The people that he's used to bring adjustments in my life have not always been folks like you. Sometimes they've been people who, well, it's very important that we keep our hearts in such a way that we can discern his purposes. Because you see, we cannot afford to become religious people. I'm not saying that we have. I'm just saying we can't afford to do that. We can't afford to be religious people. And here's why. Because religious people always see themselves in the very best light. They always see themselves as being right. And yet we see in the book of Revelation, when it comes to religious people, God sees them oftentimes anyway in a very different light. Here's what Yeshua said in Revelation 3 verse 17. "Because you say, I am rich," that is your perception of yourself, "have become wealthy and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." How's that for being straight? "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see." I think it's really important to underscore the statement here that we buy from him gold that has been refined in the fire, or if you will, it's been placed in a furnace. Because it's in that furnace where all of those things that are unfruitful, all of those things that are detrimental can be burned up and consumed. And so what he's saying is, I want you to go through the fire. It is needful for you to go through the fire. Because if you don't go through the fire, you may see yourself in a completely different way than how I see you. And this is also important for us to see in relation to our Torah portion, because Israel was preparing to meet God at the mountain. He was getting ready to come down the top of the mountain and have a face-to-face, as it were, with his people. And so if we believe that we are living in the age of redemption, and I think most of us believe that we are, because of all these things that he talks about in Luke 21 have already begun to happen, signs in the heavens, sun, moon, and stars, the distress of nations on the earth, the sea and the waves roaring, the perplexity of the nations. He said, when you see those things begin to happen, you are to look up, lift up your head. Why? Because your redemption is at hand. And so if we're living in the age of redemption, here's what that means. We are needful to prepare ourselves because there is soon to be a face-to-face, as it were, with the Almighty. And unfortunately, to some he will say, I never knew you. Again, that is the most tragic verse in all of Scripture. To think you know him only to find out you knew about him. I do not want to be in that club. Jethro came to know that Yehovah is Lord. And then he responded accordingly. And all of this unfolded at the foot of the mountain, Mount Sinai, the place where the covenant was going to be presented, the place where the Creator was going to meet with his people, where this encounter was going to occur. And the reason that they had been brought to this mountain was so, A, they could be joined together as a people, and so that they could be presented unto him as one people. Because he's going to give them one law for both the homeborn and for the stranger. And that was going to really consolidate and unite them as a nation. In fact, rabbinically, it's understood that this is where the kingdom of God was first inaugurated in the earth. So think about the idea of being joined together and then being presented unto him as one people. And I won't go into it today, but go home and read Ephesians chapter 2 and understand why Yeshua came to die on that tree and be resurrected so that he could bring two that have been apart back together and that he may present them as one body unto the Father. And all of this that has happened is a portent of things that will happen. Because the prophet Hosea says that there is a future time when all of these events that culminated in Israel coming to the foot of the mountain will be replayed. It will happen again. So we're going to go to Hosea chapter 2. I'm going to read starting in verse 14. Therefore, behold, I will allure her. That is Israel. That is his people. I will allure her, will bring her into the wilderness and speak comfort to her. I will give her her vineyards from there and the valley of Achor as a door of hope. She shall sing there as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be in that day, says the Lord, that you will call me Ishi. All right, Hebrew class. Ish means man or husband. Ishi means my husband. You're going to call me my man. My husband, that's what he's saying. You will no longer call me Bali, my master. For I will take from her mouth the names of the Baalim, those other husbands. That's what Baal is, or Baal. It means, it's translated as Lord or master, but in reality it is husband. And so what he's saying is all of these other husbands, all these other lovers that you have cavorted with, all these other gods that you have cavorted with, I'm going to take the names of those other lovers out of your mouth, and you are going to be joined to me as wife to a husband. For I will take from her mouth the names of the Baals, and they shall be remembered by their name no more. And remember, name is not just what you call it. The reputation it has attached to it, the sovereignty, the authority it has had in our lives, those things will be removed as well. And I'm going to go down to verse 19. I will betroth you to me forever. Yes, I will betroth you to me in righteousness and justice, in loving kindness and mercy. And I will betroth you to me in faithfulness. And what does it say? You shall know Yehovah. You shall know the Lord. And let's go down to verse 23. Then I will sow her, that is Jezreel, or Yezreel. Remember in Hosea chapter 1, what happened? He told the prophet to take a wife of harlotry by the name of Gomer, and they had a son that was named Yezreel, or Jezreel, which means to scatter, because I'm going to scatter the house of Israel throughout the nations because of their idolatry. But Yezreel also means to sow. And so the imagery is this, that sower in Mark chapter 4 who was sowing seed. He goes out and he sows seed. Some falls on the wayside. Some falls among the thorns and thistles. Some falls among the stony ground, but some falls on good ground. How is he sowing that seed? By scattering. So he's saying, even though I sow Jezreel, I will sow her for myself in the earth. By the way, we don't have time to go into this because this goes off on a little rabbi trail here. He's talking about you and me here too. Because Jezreel speaks to the fact that he was going to sow his people throughout the world. And that one day they were going to come up out of the land. And he was talking about in Hosea 1 how there was going to be these two that were going to come together as one. And they would appoint for themselves Urosh Echad, one head. There'd be one king. There'd be one leader. And they'd all come together as one. So this is kind of a following up on that. And what is he going to do? He's going to bring them out in the wilderness, just like I did when I brought you up out of the land of Egypt. He was bringing them out of that situation to bring them together as one so that they could be presented to him as one. I will sow her for myself in the earth. And listen to this, and I will have mercy on her who had not obtained mercy. Remember what Peter said? He said, quoting Hosea, he was talking to the believers. He says, you are people who had not been shown mercy, but now you have obtained mercy. And then Hosea goes on and says, I will say to those who were not my people, you are my people. Peter also said these same things to the believers who once were not a people, but had now become the people of God. So this is to do with you and me. And when he says, you are my people, what will they say? You are my God. So a footnote here. This is just something to me is just kind of interesting. Jethro is a Midianite. He's from the area of Midian. And today, that is present day Saudi Arabia. So in a sense, Jethro is an Arabian. He's an Arab. And what does he do? He comes and plays a very, I think, critical role in what the Father is doing in his people as they prepare to meet with him on the mountain. I would suspect that the same is going to be true in the last days. There are going to be people that are going to come and join themselves to the house of Israel that we're going to be shocked at who they are. We're going to be surprised because it's not going to be what we've imagined. Here's what I'm getting at. Elijah, during the famine, do you remember what the Creator did in order to feed Elijah? He sent ravens. Ravens, which are unclean birds, he sent ravens to give him meat and bread twice a day. Now, here's the Hebrew word for raven, orevim. Orevim. And it stems from the root word arav, which means to mix or to mingle. It's also the Hebrew word for Arab. So in the days of Elijah, and oh, by the way, these are the days of Elijah, right? Well, it must be because we sing it all the time. So in the days of Elijah, the Creator used things that were unclean in order to sustain his prophet. In other words, God uses things, people. He does things that if we focus on the thing, we will miss his purpose. Something for us to keep in mind. Their arrival at Mount Sinai, the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai, is viewed rabbinically as the climax of the Exodus. This is what the Passover was all about. This is what the whole liberation from Egypt was all about. In fact, Shavuot, which is the day, or Pentecost, which is linked to this giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai, is called a Nazaret. And in Hebrew, Nazaret, for lack of a better word, means a conclusion. So the Nazaret of Shavuot or Pentecost is seen as the goal of what happened at Pesach. In other words, if they ate the Pesach, were liberated from Egypt, and had all this freedom, but didn't have rules and instructions in how to live, what good would that freedom been for them? Because freedom, liberty without law, you know what it leads to? Anarchy. Lawlessness. Let's put it this way. If Yeshua was crucified but had not been resurrected, where would we be right now? We'd be yet in our sin, Paul says. So one doesn't work without the other. And so they had to go to Mount Sinai to receive instruction in how to live. By the way, the resurrection of the Messiah also made the book of Acts possible. And by the way, the book of Acts, if you didn't know this, hasn't finished yet. The book of Acts is still being written. You realize that? Because you and I are his witnesses. And we're still actively engaged in what the book of Acts is all about. And it's all predicated on the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Messiah. So, as I said earlier, the covenant that was given at Mount Sinai was to bring all of the tribes into allegiance with the one God. That doesn't mean the tribes gave up their unique qualities, and it doesn't mean the tribes always saw eye to eye on everything. It just meant that the tribes decided to get their eyes off of one another and their focus on the one and only, the true God, who was at their head, to focus not on the person, but to focus on his purpose. And what was his purpose in bringing them into the wilderness, gathering them at the foot of the mountain to give them in the instructions? Because they had a purpose to serve, to be a light to the rest of the nations. So then, in Exodus 19, verse 1, in the third month, after the children of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on the same day, they came to the wilderness of Sinai, or Sinai. For they had departed from Rephidim, had come to the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. And so Israel camped there before the mountain. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians. They didn't hear about it. They saw it. And how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy or a set apart nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. And so first, I want you to recall that in Exodus chapter 3, when Moses encountered the Creator at the burning bush, one of the things that God told him at that point is, as a sign that I've done this, you're going to bring all the people and worship me on this mountain. So this is the fulfillment of what he told them back there in Exodus 3. And also, because we just read this, the events that occurred at Mount Sinai in Exodus 19 and 20 are a precursor of what Hosea described will happen in the last days. Maybe for some of you that's not new. You've heard that before. But there are a lot of believers out there who have no idea of what the Creator is going to do and how he's going to do it. We have this, what we've been told and what our perceptions are. But when we actually go back and read the book, which is a novel idea if you think about it, to actually read and see what he said, he is saying that there is coming a day he is going to bring his people out into the wilderness just as he did when they were coming out of Egypt. Now, either it means what it says, or he's messing with me. Anyway. So this is looking back on something, and it's looking toward something. And then we are told that the Creator came down on top of the mountain in a thick cloud, a canopy. I want to use that word. Because that canopy is emblematic of what we just did here with the children. The chuppah. That's what the chuppah is. It is a canopy. And so the Creator comes down on top of the mountain in this thick, dark cloud. Because we can't look upon him and live, right? So he wasn't doing that to be mysterious. He was doing that for their own good. But this thick, dark cloud forms this canopy over the mountain. And that is why Shavuot is also regarded as we being betrothed to him. The instructions, the commandments are his ketuvah, his wedding contract. This is what I will do. This is what I expect of you. And to that they replied, whatever the Lord says, We will hear and we will do. Now, I want to show you the Hebrew word chuppah for just a moment because it's something I thought was kind of neat. It's spelled chet, pe, or fe, he, chuppah. But it can be read this way, chet. And the letter chet, the one that is all the way on the right, a lot of you already know that that letter represents chai, life. A lot of people will wear, you know, something around on the chain, and it'll either be chet yud, which chai, life. Sometimes it's just the chet itself, but it represents life. And the word pe, hey, is the word po, which means here. So the idea behind the chuppah is when you come under his covering, guess what? Life is here. That's where we find life. And to get to that chuppah in Exodus 19, what do they have to be willing to do? They have to wander through the wilderness. They have to go out into the wilderness. That's where he allures her. That's where he's drawing her. That's where he's, I want to say this in a very respectful way, but the Hebrew actually does kind of get into the idea of he's like, come on, honey. Come on. Come here with me. Because it is that kind of an intimate relationship that he's longing for and that he wants us to long for with him. And so he's alluring her into the wilderness to come under the chuppah, because the chuppah is used when a man and a woman join themselves in marriage and they become one. But it is emblematic of the fact that under his covering there is life. So then what could we deduce about that when it comes to not being willing to come under his covering? He reminds them that they were eyewitnesses to all of the things that he had done. Again, Jethro heard about it. Amalek heard about it. But Israel, they didn't hear about it. They didn't have to rely on somebody's account of things. They saw it firsthand. And not just the splitting of the sea. Not just the destruction of Pharaoh and his chariots in the sea, but they had witnessed all the things that had transpired before that. They had witnessed firsthand how he set a distinction between them and Egypt so that when there was darkness upon the land of Egypt for 3 days that could be felt, there was light in their homes. They were witnesses of these things. And as firsthand witnesses of these things, they were to go out and to testify to others of these things. That's why they're called a light to the nations. It's not that it's a light that shines and says, look at us, calling attention to us. It is a light that oftentimes has to go into the darkness to draw those people who dwell in darkness out into that light, to be his witnesses. When Yeshua is on the Mount of Olives with all those people who were assembled there and they're asking him, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Is it the time for all these things to come to pass? His answer was, in Bill's version, that's not what I want you focused on right now. There is a time for that. The Father's got that all under control. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to tarry in Jerusalem until you are empowered by the Holy Spirit. And then, starting in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria. By the way, that's people you don't like. Start with the people you do like. And then branch out and get into a situation where you're having to talk to people you don't like. And then to the world. Those are the people who don't want to hear anything you have to say. But I want you to go to them anyway and to be witnesses of me. That is to be witnesses of the resurrected Messiah. Because you see, we too have witnessed firsthand how he has liberated us from Egypt, from bondage. We have seen firsthand how he has done great and marvelous things in our lives, have we not? And because we have, we are compelled to be witnesses of that. So back in Exodus 19, the statements he makes here are followed by this, I brought you unto myself. I brought you unto myself. He brought them to him. And it's important to make this clear because it is the Creator who is performing this. In other words, they couldn't save themselves. They could not liberate themselves. Only he could do these things. And so I think it's important for you and me in applying this to our lives and where we are today to know and to recognize that he is the one who has brought us to this place. He is the one who has brought us to this time. And however we got here, you know, some of you know my story, my background, raised in Church of God, Pentecostal church, and I, again, don't disparage or disdain that. I don't agree with everything that happened back then. I don't agree with everything I learned back then. Nevertheless, that is a big reason or a big part of the reason I am here, because ultimately he's the one who has brought me here. He's the one who has brought me to this place. And if that's true, then he's going to be the one that's going to take me the next step and the next step and the next step and bring me into the fullness of what he has for my life. And the same is true for each and every one of us here. Now, I'm going to choose my words carefully here. Wherever we are in life, if we don't really think he's the one that's brought us here, then we need to figure out where it is we're supposed to be. We believe that he has brought us to this point. And if we believe that, how then are we to respond to that? We need to keep our eyes on his purpose. He says, if they hear and obey, then they will be a peculiar treasure. Then they will be that treasured possession. In Hebrew, the word is segula. And this is something, a word I bring up from time to time. Segula is samech gimel lamed hei, segula. And it literally means a treasure or a jewel. And so he's saying, if you will hear my voice, if you'll keep my covenant, then you'll be a jewel. Then you'll be my treasured possession. And that's really important, I think, to underscore, because they've already been saved. They've already been delivered. How were they delivered? Because they placed their trust in that blood that was on the doorposts and lintels of their home. All right? So they've already been saved. They've already been saved from their bondage. But now what does he say? Now that you're saved, there is a way I want you to behave. If we're going to be in this relationship, if you're going to be my special treasure, then you need to hear what I'm saying. You need to obey what I'm saying. And then you'll be this very special jewel. The root of segula means something that is elect. Something that is exclusive. It's considered to be very rare. It's considered to be very valuable. In fact, so valuable that you might be inclined to put it in a safe place if there's any threat. Put it in a box to secure it, to shut it up, because it is so valuable. Except in this particular case, the Creator doesn't want us to be shut up, and he doesn't want us to shut up. He wants us to be his witnesses. He wants us to be out there so that even our enemies take note of us. You are a city set upon a hill that cannot be hidden. That is the value. I won't spend a lot of time on this because we have spent so much time on it before. But I do think it merits just mentioning very quickly. And that is gems, precious stones, jewels. They're stones. And as we all know by now, stones are formed from heat, pressure, friction, all this stuff, all these, those things that happen in a furnace. And common stones like granite and marble and all these things, they are produced by heat and friction and all this pressure. And so if it's a precious stone, all that is saying is it has been subjected to even more heat, even more pressure than those things that are common. And so we are not regarded as common stones. We are called living stones. And I would suggest to you that those living stones are the kind that adorn the breastplate of the high priest, those gems, those precious stones. You know, a diamond in the rough is mine, and I've never seen this but once, but it's not really all that attractive. You have to be the artisan to see its beauty in that situation, in that state. And so that's why that artisan will cut in a certain way, to cut away those things that aren't needful in order to bring out the brilliance of that particular stone. And so you have to be able to, at that point, hold it up to a light to appreciate what that artisan has brought out. He's brought out that diamond in the rough. So that's kind of what he's doing with us. But the treasured status, as far as you and I are concerned, is not in the item itself, but in its purpose. A diamond that doesn't serve God's purpose is less valuable than a piece of granite that does. Because it's not about what it looks like. It's not about the form, per se. It's about the purpose, the function. I'm going to keep pounding that until the day I die. So Israel is not called to be those that everyone looks upon them and adores them. Israel is called to serve the one that should be adored and reverenced and worshiped. That is our service, to be his witnesses. We're not called because we are great. We are called to do great things. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6, Moses says, "You are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure, segula, above all the peoples on the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love on you nor choose you because you were more in number than any other people, for you were the least of all peoples." In other words, you weren't called because you were great. I wasn't called because I was great. We were called to do great things, as he defines great things. We were called to serve his purpose, which is why it is very needful that we keep our eyes on his purpose. And as such, he says that we were called to be a kingdom of priests. By the way, at this point in time, that's the whole nation. I want you to see that. At this point in time, he is calling upon the whole nation to be a kingdom of priests. Because it seems to me that was plan A. Plan B, the Levitical priesthood, comes about because why? Transgression, the golden calf incident. So it seems that initially, anyway, his intention was that the entire nation be a kingdom of priests, and they were to teach each other, they were to teach others to join themselves to the Almighty, not to isolate themselves. They were people, we are people, who are called to invite his presence into our midst, and then his presence within us is to resonate and affect those who are the outsiders, so to speak. Isaiah 61, verse 6, "You will be called the priests of the Lord, ministers of God." And again, they were not to isolate themselves, to hoard what they knew and their experience. They were to resonate that. They were to be witnesses of that. And nothing's changed. Now, I want to go back to something here real quick. When he talks about how I have borne you unto myself upon eagle's wings, and he brought them into the wilderness. So keep that in mind as we read this very, very familiar passage in Isaiah chapter 40. "But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." And I wanted to read this because I believe that him mentioning eagle's wings is to connect us here to what he said in Exodus 19. And although we won't go into this, also something that is related to us in Revelation 12, when the woman goes into the wilderness, into the place where the Father has prepared for her on eagle's wings. But here in Isaiah, here's what we want to look at. The word wait. That word there. And I've heard different teaching on this and what that's supposed to convey to us. But here's what the Hebrew word kava means. Kava. It's kuf vav he. We translate it as wait or tarry. But the word actually, the stem actually means something that's being stretched, something that's being twisted and, you know, stretched to, you know, as far as it'll go. Some of you are onto what I'm talking about right now, right? So the idea here is that the waiting implies that you are being stretched. You feel like you've been twisted and contorted and stretched almost to the breaking point, which means as you're being strained in this way, you're having to endure a lot. And some of the endurance has nothing to do with what's going on outside here. A lot of it is enduring what's going on inside here, because that's why he's stretching you in the first place. That's why he stretches me, not so I can focus on your problems. He stretches me so I can look at the things that are going on inside here. So again, I can't focus on the person, I have to focus on the purpose. So I just thought that was pretty insightful to know that those that wait, and that connects to the idea of being stretched. He's saying that those who are going through this process, one day your strength is going to be renewed. Man, I'm ready. Now, I say I'm ready. He may have something else to say about the matter. And that's why we have to wait. So as we are yearning, we're looking very intently toward this time when our strength is going to be renewed. We're hopeful for that. He's saying those that are willing to endure this, that one day your strength is going to be renewed, and when that happens, you will mount up with wings as eagles. You'll run and not grow weary. I'm walking and I get weary. And I don't mean that necessarily in the literal physical sense. I'm talking about day in, day out, just dealing with life. I'm weary. I'm worn down. Bill, you shouldn't tell us that. You're the guy who's supposed to be leading this thing. I'm just telling you how it is. Okay? I'm weary, I'm tired, but I realize that that's part of it, because I just read that that must be part of it. Because as I'm being stretched, as we're being stretched, we're weary, we're tired. But he says there is coming a day when our strength will be renewed, that we will mount up with wings as eagles. We will run and not be weary. We will walk and we will not become faint. That word kavah also means this, to collect or to gather together in order to serve a common purpose. I'm going to be brave, go out on a limb, and I'm going to say this, that in my heart I know that this little fellowship here was God-breathed, God-ordained. It needs to always be God-led and guided by his presence and his spirit. It never needs to rely on a man, a woman, a family. It needs to be a group of people coming together for the common purpose that he has for us. Okay? We all agree with that, don't we? Okay? Also going hand in glove with that is this, that if we believe that, then we need to understand that each and every one of us, to some degree or the other, is going to be stretched. And as we're being stretched, as we're being learning endurance, it's really important as we go through this process not to let our frustration be focused on that one, this one, or that situation. It needs to be, our focus needs to be on what his purpose is in all of this, to realize that he's doing something in me. This is about what he's doing in me, or it's about what he's doing in you, but I need to focus on his purpose for me. Can we all agree to that? Yeah. Because there is coming a day that, if that's true for this congregation, there is coming a day that he will renew our strength and we will mount up with wings as eagles. Now, I need to go ahead and say this, and this is jumping a little bit ahead as far as the story goes. But there were those at Israel, the same people he's speaking to here in Exodus 19, who were at the foot of that mountain, who heard the voice of the Almighty speak, and they couldn't wait. When Moses went to the top of the mountain, to do exactly what they had asked Moses to do. Find out what it is we need to know. Come back and tell us. We'll hear it. We'll do it. But there were those who couldn't wait because they were being stretched too far. And they felt like, we got to fix something. We got to do something. We got to make something happen. And you know the story, how they went to Aaron, how the golden calf was crafted. And here's my point. They couldn't wait. And some of them, because they couldn't wait, entered into rebellion. They entered into rebellion, and what did they do? They took something that they were familiar with, something warm and fuzzy, and they tried to fit the Almighty into what they could comprehend, what they could connect to, what they could touch, what they could handle, what something familiar with them. But how many of us understand he is never going to fit into our image of what it's supposed to be? He's never going to fit into what I think it should be, how I think it should look, how I think it should sound. Because just about the time we figured out who the Antichrist is, he gets shot in the head. I threw you a curveball right there. I realize that. But my point is it almost never works out the way we envision it. That's why we have to keep our eyes on his purpose. And by the way, the unfortunate part in that story is because there were some who couldn't wait, and because they entered into rebellion, it cost them their life. I don't want to be in that club either. That then accentuates this. Exodus 19, verse 9. And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I come to you in the thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you and believe you forever." And so Moses told the words of the people to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes, and let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people." So what I want to focus on very quickly is this. He told them to sanctify themselves today and tomorrow, and then he told them to wash their clothes, because they had to prepare themselves to have this encounter with the Almighty. So to sanctify themselves, to set themselves apart, implies that they were to avoid any kind of spiritual contamination, tuma in Hebrew, because they're going to be going before the Creator of all things. And they were told to wash their garments, which I kind of take that to be an outward sign, an outward demonstration of something that should reflect what's going on within that person. And this reminds us of the fact that there are multiple times in Scripture when just before an encounter with the Almighty, people had to change their garments. Remember when Jacob comes back into the land, he's got to go fulfill his vow at Bethel, and he tells everybody in his family, "You got to wash yourself and change your clothes. You can't wear those garments up there." Before ascending the Temple Mount, what did the people have to do? They had to immerse themselves in the mikveh. They had to take this ceremonial bath, as it were, but they were to cleanse themselves from all the road dust and all these things. Why? Because they were about to enter the courts of the Almighty. In Zechariah chapter 3, the high priest is told to change, have his garments changed, to put a clean turban on his head. Why? Because in living life, his garments have picked up dust and pollutants and trash. And before you go meet the Almighty, you can't go in wearing all that stuff. So here's how I want to relate that to you and to me. If we do believe we're living in the days of redemption, if we do believe that he is gathering his people for a common purpose, not just this little congregation, but if he's doing something here, then guess what? He's doing the same thing down the road. He's doing the same thing in the next community. He's doing the same thing in that state or in that country. It's not just you and me. But if he's doing these things and he's beginning to gather his people for a common purpose, then we should take note of this fact, that before we have this encounter with him, we can't go before him wearing the dirt that we've picked up that yesterday. If we're still wearing the dirt that we've collected from the past, and I hope you understand what I mean by that terminology, all the stuff that we picked up from the past that affects our mind, affects our heart, affects how we live our lives, how we approach his purpose, we're going to have to be willing, starting with me, we're going to have to be willing to wash all those things and to change our garments. There comes a time when we have to forget those things that are back here and set our sights on what is before. There was a very smart man by the name of Shaul who said something or words to that effect. There comes a time when we have to forget all of this stuff back here and we need to start focusing on what he has set before us. And we have to press toward that mark of the high calling, which is in Messiah. So then, as a bride, as a prospective bride, we understand that we are soon to encounter and come face to face with our King. It may not happen next week or the week after that, but if we're living this day and time, we anticipate that soon we will come face to face with our King. And in preparation of that, we have to be ones who are willing to prepare ourselves, to make ourselves ready. There isn't any way around that. So in verse 16 of Exodus 19, it says, "Then it came to pass on the third day, in the morning, that there were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain, and the sound of the trumpet was very loud, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled." They were freaking out. It was a frightening sight. "And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now, Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly." I wish I had a lot more time to go into some of the details of this. We'll probably cover it more in Shavuot. But here's something I do want you to know. The word thunderings in Hebrew is kolot. And kolot literally means voices. They were hearing sounds, and it is implied anyway that the possibility exists. They were hearing voices and more than one. Here's what I'm getting at. In Revelation 6, what surrounds the throne of God? Four living creatures, right? And what are they, what sounds would someone who is witnessing the throne room of God, what would they hear? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. In Revelation 10, it talks about how there are seven thunders that utter their voice throughout the earth. And so there are places in Scripture where we see that God's voice is often likened unto thunder. When Yeshua is coming into Jerusalem, the Father speaks, and some people thought it had thundered because they couldn't discern the voice of God. All they heard was thunder. So here's what we're getting at. There is this belief that at Mount Sinai, that the throne of God came down upon the top of the mountain, which is another reason it was engulfed in this thick, dark cloud. And these voices are rumbling, and the people witness this. They hear this, and that's one of the reasons they're freaking out. Yeah, I grew up in a Pentecostal church, and it was almost every service that we would say, "We want to see your glory." We've sang that here. And I know what we think we mean when we say that. But the thing is, if he ever showed up in this way, every one of us would be flat on our face. And that's how we'll know when he has shown up in that measure. We will all be flat on our face because no flesh will glory in my presence, he says. It says that the mountain was smoking. In Isaiah chapter 6, when he has a vision of the throne room of God, it was filled with smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire and the smoke ascended like a furnace. So I want to come back to that thought. He uses the word furnace, and in Hebrew it's kavash. It's kaf, bet, shin. And that word actually means to subdue, to subject. And it becomes the word furnace because the idea here, once again, is that when you put something in a furnace, those things that are unfruitful, those things that are not conducive to the purpose and the function that this artisan has in mind. It's intended that those things be burned up or that they be separated from so that they can be removed entirely. So here is the idea that the Creator comes in this way with this demonstration to remind us, number one, that He is a consuming fire. And in that consuming fire, it is intended that all those things about you and me that are unfruitful be consumed, that they be removed. And so I'll kind of close with this thought here. I want to go to Hebrews chapter 12. In verse 18, he says, "For you have not come to the mountain that may be touched and that burned with fire, and to blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore." Of course, he's referring back to what's going on in Exodus 19, what happened in Exodus 20. And so the people of God are begging for God to hush. Here's why. For they could not endure what was commanded. They couldn't wait. They couldn't endure the stretching that he was putting them through. And they begin to look for a way to fix this. So it suited them. And so going on down to here it says, "And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I am exceedingly afraid and trembling." Now it goes on to say that in the future, that this is going to happen again, that the world is going to experience something very similar to this again. Hey, y'all put that down for just a little bit while we finish up, okay? Thank you. In verse 25, it says, "See that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he has promised, saying, yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also heaven." So the mountain quaked back in Exodus 19, but what the writer of Hebrews is saying is that one day the mountains are going to quake and the powers of the heavens are going to be shaken as well. That's what Messiah said. And here's why, he says, "Now this yet once more indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain." And so I'll summarize that this way. I think the stretching has begun. What do you think? Some of you are not certain. For those who aren't certain, just wait. Okay. The stretching has begun. And so what is he calling us to do? To acknowledge those things that need to be expunged from our lives, to separate those things from our lives, to purify our hearts, to make ourselves ready, and to endure this stretching, to hold on, to hope for that day when he renews our strength and we mount up with wings as eagle, to not turn our ear away from what he's saying. They thought that if God will just hush, we'll be okay. We can't handle this. We're going to die if he doesn't hush. But what happened was because he acknowledged that what they said was right. If I keep talking, they're going to die. That is to themselves, to their will. We need the Father to speak into our lives if we want to live. So the shaking has begun, and it is very important that we don't refuse him who is speaking to us. Because he is, I believe, preparing, if not already doing, he is shaking those things to determine what needs to fall, what needs to crumble in our lives as individuals across this world, so that what's left is standing on what is sure and what is proven and what is true. There will come a day when all of these things will crumble and fall, and people will be looking for something that is sure, something that is true, something that is proven. And that something is the rock the Messiah said that he was going to build his congregation on. And that's the congregation I want to be part of. And so if that is so, then we just need to be aware of the fact we shouldn't be surprised if we're being stretched. We shouldn't be surprised if things are popping up and bubbling to the surface. I didn't ask for permission, but I'm going to share something real quick here that just kind of, I think it's important. Many years ago, Beth and I were at a conference, and I had to speak early that morning, and it had been a late night, and she was still asleep, and I just walked over, and I was just going to kind of give her a peck on the forehead, and I was going to go my way, and when I did that, she woke up, and this is what she said to me. It's not good morning, hey, honey, anything like that. It was, I've just seen the consuming fire of God. Now, if that won't get your attention, I'm not sure what will. So I'm like, okay. And I'm going to make this very brief, but she described to me a dream in which she saw a storm coming through. And we were looking outside our windows, and we saw a storm coming, or she saw a storm coming through. And there were these large, very mature trees that in the face of this storm, they were breaking, they were falling, they were being uprooted and laid along the side. And at the same time, there were little saplings that were blowing in the wind, but were not moved. Scene two was, we were looking outside and there were things in our yard, things that as food would be considered to be unclean. And there were things, these little storms that were small and very specific and very intricate, were coming into our yard and picking up things out of our yard and at the same time leaving others. And so we concluded that what he was saying to us is that there will come a time that there are things that people have looked to that are familiar, that they have trusted in, they've placed their confidence in, that the storms that are coming will move those things out of the way. But the things that he's doing, those things that he's growing, those things that are coming up as little saplings, they may sway in the wind, but they're going to remain. So it's not the big oak tree that stayed. It was the little insignificant sapling that remained. Personally, there were things in our lives that he had to deal with. There were things that he was removing out of our lives that weren't clean, those things that had to be purged from our lives in preparation for what happened next. And that was, we were in this house, and we looked out the window, and there it was this fire tornado, and it was huge. And as it approached, you got this sensation, there is no way we can survive this. But as it moved through, it consumed other things, but to us, it provided warmth and contentment and safety. And we took that to mean that if we respond to what he's telling us to do in our lives and to make ourselves ready, then what he's going to bring upon the earth for you, for me, those that respond to his voice, will be exactly what he told the congregation of Philadelphia. I will keep you in the trial that is coming upon the world to test those who dwell upon the earth. So I'll close with this statement. However he's stretching you, you need to make sure that you focus on his purpose. And we need to make sure collectively that we are allowing him to work in our lives so that this fire that he's bringing into our lives consumes those things that are not fruitful and conducive to his will and purpose, so that the fire of his presence may be within us and it may resonate outward to draw people who are in darkness to come into his light. Don't be surprised at who he uses, how he does it, when he does it. Don't try to fit him into our box and what we think is right and what's familiar to us. Amen? Father, first of all, we thank you for your word, and I pray, Father, that your word within the words will be what resonates within our heart, what pierces our spirit. And I pray, Father, that whatever it is that each and every one of us need individually, that is what you will impart by your spirit. I pray, Father, that you will help us all to embrace your will for our life, knowing that it will require us to be willing to climb up on the altar and let self be consumed so that it is no longer I who lives, but it's Messiah who lives in me. I thank you, Father, for your goodness to your people. Thank you, Father, for your mercy and your compassion. I thank you for your long suffering. I thank you that we can know that because your eye is on that sparrow, that you are watching over me, because we know that we have more value than that hair that you count on the top of our head, that we, as your people, we have more value than that. And we pray, Father, that we will see the value in allowing you to continue working in our lives to transform us into the image of your Son. In Yeshua's name, we thank you. Amen. Beth, will you come up and she's going to share some prayer requests with you. Did you see?
So I woke up around 3 this morning, and I was just saying, okay, Abba, what's going on? This seems to be kind of a thing on Friday nights now. So I just started praying, and then I had to pick up my phone and make some notes. And so some of those are your prayer requests that come in, and you online. Some things he just brings to my attention. Some things, some people he brings to my mind to pray for. And it's interesting that when I went to sleep last night, I think I had one thing on the list to bring to you for prayer this morning. And I said, Abba, you know, you give me this time. Surely there's more than that that you want me to bring. There's so much out there, but I don't put it down unless he gives it to me. And between the time I got here this morning, even on the way in, to now, the list is very long. So I will, I'll just be quick. Some of them are pretty urgent. One is Xander Losey. We need to pray for him. Little bitty guy. He's what, 3 or 4? He's what? He's 3, okay. Robert Naylor's little grandson. He had a tick bite on his neck. And when they pulled it out last night, they thought it was going to be okay. But this morning, it had the little bullseye around it. So they took him in and he is going to be okay. Okay, well, we have a report. He went and got checked out first thing today, and he's going to be okay. But let's keep praying that, you know, Lyme disease is far from him, that there's not going to be any effects, that this will just go away, and his little system will call all the troops in to fight whatever needs to be fought there, and that he'll be perfectly well. Lorraine is one of our streamers. And I got a request for her to pray for their little prayer group. They meet and pray, and they watch Jacob's Tent online. But this morning, she prayed, asked for an urgent prayer for Christina. I'm not sure what the issues are, but her husband was not able to revive her this morning. They called an ambulance, and I've not had a report back. So let's pray for Lorraine's friend Christina and for her husband. As soon as I have more to report there, I will. Another one of our streamers, Laura Lee, we want to pray for her mother. She's been in a lot of pain, and she wants to enjoy the service, but the pain is tremendous right now. Janet Rex wrote, this lady we've known for how long now? A long, long time. She is a prayer warrior, and she has had the Father show her things that, you know, just blown our minds, you know, for me and Bill personally, as well as other situations. And she's really a prayer warrior. She definitely hears from the Father. And we know that if you're one of those kind of people, the enemy's not going to like you even more. And she needs our prayer this morning. She hears from him. She also needs us to hold her arms up once in a while. She's always on here with us. She's always encouraging us, cheering us on, in agreement. Right now, she needs healing of her kidneys and to not need dialysis or a transplant. So if y'all will pray with us for her, Janet, we love you. We know that the Father has a plan in this, just like he does in every other thing that we pray about. But, you know, it makes me angry, I guess it's okay to say that, when he attacks our family, and when he attacks our prayer warriors. I know we're, how can I say this nicely, we're ticking him off. We're messing with him. So Just pray for Janet. Dawn Irion's mother, Beth, had open heart surgery. This is Kim Hood's friend, and she sent in a prayer request for that. So let's pray for that. She's doing better. The surgery went well. So let's continue for her strength to return and her to be better than before. Cherry Meredith is sick. Cherry is the lady who has the company that cleans our church and several of the other churches in this area. And she works very hard. So let's keep her in prayer. They have changes going on right now, and she's working double time right now. So just pray for her. And Jack and Christina, a little couple, you know, has little Ellie here. Got a request from them this morning. It's a good thing. It's kind of a praise report and a prayer request all rolled in one. Someone is interested in purchasing the property that they had bought in Alabama, and this could be a really good thing for them. So let's pray for the Father's will there. David Erb, next week, Monday? Wednesday. Okay. Let's be in prayer for David. He is going to have a heart procedure done Wednesday, catheterization, I believe. Anyway, let's pray for David. That this goes beautifully, and that if there's anything that needs to be found, it'll be found and immediately corrected, but that the Father will go in ahead of time and do his own thing before, and they'll just go, well, we don't know what the problem was, but we don't see anything, and he's better, and we're done. So anyway, Miss Jean, she came through the surgery for her cataracts and is doing good, but she's got another issue now, and we want to pray that she doesn't deal with glaucoma. So we're praying for you, Miss Jean. And then I'll just add one more. And there are so many. Marlene had given me a page from the prayer meeting Wednesday. And there, I mean, if I don't say it up here, it's not because we didn't see it. We don't want to ignore anybody or make anybody feel left out. It's just that y'all would be so hungry by the time I got through telling you all of the ones that come in. So we have a whole page that we pray for, as well as these individual ones. Renee Swan is a dear friend of ours. She and Russell, we've known them for years and years and years. Yeah, they were at Sakote. A lot of you met them. I was going to say that. They were at Sakote. And she's one of the most hospitable people you'll ever want to meet, and very sincere and very excited to be serving the Lord. She is running for Congress in Texas, and she just had a very wonderful endorsement. It's very worked very well in her favor. We already see her in that seat, and not that who she's replacing is one that was a bad person, but we want to see those who don't need to be there unseated, and the Father's people put in those places. So please pray for her, because you know when you're gaining ground, the enemy doesn't like it, and he's going to come at you with everything he has. And Bill sent me a little meme this week, and I have to do it. Okay, so this is for you, Renee. I'm not going to be able to do it like Bill did, but he sent me a picture of this owl bobbing his head, you know, like they do when they're getting ready to go and get their prey that they found it. And so Bill sends me this meme that says, come at me, bro. You know, that's for you, Renee. Go get them. So we're on your side. And if the enemy thinks he's coming after her, he's got a whole bunch of family to deal with, those of us here and those out there. So anyway, we pray for protection and favor for her, because we know those who are in opposition can be really nasty. So it's not us he's coming at, it's him. And that's a whole lot worse for those who are on the attack. So Renee, we love you, you and Russell both, and we're praying for you. There's a lot more, and I could go on and on. One last one. Alan and Allison's piano teacher, she's going through chemotherapy right now, and Cynthia Kissinger is her name. So if you will just pray for her. She went the natural route. She's been fighting this for a year, and I told her just yesterday, I believe that the Father just was using that year to prep her body for the next step in this. And sometimes the natural process in a fallen world is just not enough. And sometimes you have to go the extra step. And so we just need to pray for her, because she's heartbroken. They have a prison ministry, and they teach the children music, and she can't do any of that right now. So I pray for financial favor for them and for a speedy healing and recovery from this. So if you will, lift up Cynthia as well.
Okay. I'll tell you what, I'm going to do something a little different today. Robert, I'm going to call on you, brother, and any two or three more of you brethren that would come down here. I want a couple of people, a couple of brothers I want us to pray for and actually anoint with oil today. We can do that. Adam, will you join Robert? If any of you brethren who feel led to join these men, I want you to come down here. But I want David, Daniel, I want you to come down here, brother. I don't want you, specifically, I want us to pray for these two, brother. You know, Daniel's, he's enduring some things himself right now. And so what I want to do is I want you to pray for these guys here. If there are anyone else that you like somebody to pray with you, you know, Beth and I'll make ourselves available to do that afterwards. So we're going to do that on that side. And I know this is a little different. It might be a little awkward, but I also want to invite everybody to, if you have an offering, you've prepared that, and you have a willing heart, I want you to present your offering over here. So we're going to just pray with people over here, and you can come and present your offering over here. Can we do that? We'll try not to get this too, we'll try to do the best we can with the tight quarters that we have. But I felt like that was very important that we do that today. All right? And so if you want to bring your offering down, please, you do that over here. And rather than running off, let's just be in prayer for these brothers. And if there's anybody else that you want specifically for us to pray with you, then we will do that even as we're continuing on with what we are, the other things that we have to do. Okay. So I think... in just a moment. Well, we'll do the. But if you prepared an offering, come over here. And if you want prayer, we'll let these brethren pray with you. I know this is a little different, but we're going to let them continue to pray. I want you, those of you here, if you want to pray with them, just extend your hand that way. But we're also going to go ahead and do the Aaronic blessing. I honestly can't think of a better way to continue this as we're praying for those people, that we would pray that he would set his name upon us and cause his face to shine upon us. So if you will, those who... we'll stand. Those of you who are praying over here, just continue to do that.
Yeah.
Thank you, brothers. Thank you. If there's anyone else that you'd like prayer, anything in particular, Beth and I would be happy to make ourselves available to pray with you in just a moment. Thank you, brothers, for praying with those gentlemen. And I know that we have all kinds of needs, and we just ask the Father to look upon everyone's situation with mercy and compassion and meet needs according to his purpose and will. All right. Are we preparing to do this? Are we ready? Did we get the thumbs up? Okay. Do we have a thumbs up yet? Oh, you're going to go check. Well, in the meantime, let's do this then. Let's turn around and let's welcome everybody online and say Shabbat Shalom and tell them hello. And we're glad that they're with us. Oh, we have some visitors with us today, first-time guests, and thank you so much for joining us. Yeah, you're pointing at somebody, okay? Yes. Okay, so in a moment, Beth's going to give some instructions about how we're going to do Oneg. We're kind of, be seated. We're just kind of waiting to get thumbs up. Is there anything else we need to say or announce real quick while we're waiting to find out? All right, well, we're going to have an announcement that is only in-house. So what we're going to do is we're going to do, while they're still with us, we'll go ahead and do Kiddush and Hamotzi, right?
Oh, I can say it now. It's not a secret.
Oh, okay.
It's not a secret. It's just that we've not been able to meet with a comfort foods group just for various reasons, weather, travel sickness, whatever. So today we're trying again. And is Gay here?
I think she just went out.
Okay. So, yes, she is here. So I didn't see her earlier. So what we want to do is when we release, we'll release the wheelchairs, walkers, canes, and crutches, et cetera, and then our guests. And then if you're one of the people who would like to join with Gay and the other ladies who are taking meals, either you participate by cooking or picking something up or taking paper goods or just donating a food card or something, you know, from the grocery store, any of those ways, Gay would like for you to go through the line, go ahead and get your meal and come over to the overflow room, which is right beside the nursery. And eat in there and meet in there, because when we tried it before on the other side, it was really loud. I think Brandon's working on some sound panel ideas or something like that.
I want to, but we'll see.
Okay, he wants to. He's in his head, he's working on it. With his hands, not yet. So anyway, a lot going on in that brain of his. But anyway, it'll be a lot quieter in there. You'll have the room to yourself. So meet with Gay and... that was really the only announcement I had. And we would love for you live streamers to be here. And if you want to participate and you just want to send like a grocery store food card or gift card or something like that, I guess, you know what, I don't know. email me and I'll get you information about the grocery stores in the area if that's how you would like to participate, because we don't want you to feel left out. We want you to participate if you would like to.
Okay. I don't know if we're ready or not. So, Zuriel, what's you don't know? Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to say Kiddush. All right, everybody stand with me and join with me. I guess you can get in line. If they tell you to wait, then just remember that you will renew your strength. Oh, yes, yes. Well, thank you. Adam Fullwood is asking and wanted to announce, all you men and women who would like to join with him and others in sounding the shofar when we meet, maybe come next week about 10, 15 minutes earlier than you did this week and look for Adam, and you guys will get together in one of these rooms down here and just kind of, you know, get together and rehearse and get it to, you know, kind of get on the same page, as it were. All right. Was that basically it? All right. So just if you want to do that, just come a little earlier and check with Adam, and he'll kind of coordinate that. So thank you. Thank you for reminding me. All right. I got a thumbs up. Join with me. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, and for giving us Yeshua the Messiah, who said, I am the vine, and you are the branches. L'chaim. Now, Motzi. Baruch atah Adonai. Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth, and forgiving us, Yeshua the Messiah, who said, I am the bread of life. Amen. All right, dismiss.
Okay, let's have wheelchairs, canes, walkers, and crutches. Oh, do you want to do the...
Keep you. May His grace and His faith.